Okay, hello everybody. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Francesco Giardello. He is a university teacher at Management School of the Sheffield University. And his bachelor and master degree was obtained at University of Bari in Italy, as far as I know. And his background is in mathematics, but having studied for a PhD in mathematics methods for economics and finance at the University of Foggia, also in Italy. Nice place, Foggia, at the university. Yeah. And with a thesis on the existence of Nash equilibrium in non-cooperative game. And currently, your research or his research interests are in the field of mathematical economics, also game theory, and operational research for supply chain and decision science. And today he is going to present a paper on the analysis of pure strategy in equilibria in a duopolistic market model. And go ahead, Francesco.
Okay, thank you very much, Anna, for the presentation. Everything was correct. And so, as Anna said, the paper is about strong Nash equilibria in a particular environment in a literature which is called advertising models, which is actually a branch of operational research, pure operational research. And some people, they use the expression market share models. Other people, they use the most common expression of advertising model. It's up to you. It's up to the literature that you are facing. So what I'm going to talk today is about the mathematical existence of equilibria, but not just about that. Not about the strictness or the strong of Nash equilibrium, which is a refinement of Nash equilibrium, but also about the implications, economic implications of this equilibrium. So the subtitle of the presentation, I think you can see the subtitles here, is competitive advertising really strong? So I'm actually being ironic on myself. So they are so strong. Actually, they are not so strong, and we will see in what sense they are not so strong. So the strong in the subtitle is very different from the strong in the title. So the strong in the title is a game theoretical thing. The strong in the subtitle is, an economic thing. And we will see what I mean when I say this. Okay, so let me see if, okay. So the summary of the talk, first of all. So an introduction to the advertising model, to this literature, what these models do. Then the presentation of my model, our model, because it's a paper with other authors, a duopolistic advertising model with the two effects, generic and predatory advertising. Then the settings of the game. So the game theoretical interpretation, what does it mean the Nash equilibria in this case, in this particular case. Another thing that at the beginning I excluded from the talk, but then I decided to insert, is a quick way to the proof of the main result. Why I decided to insert this? Because we could have talked about the main result, okay. But the way the proof is very interesting in order to enlarge these results. So for people who wants to work in this area, this is a nice step in this kind of things. So I will show you, obviously not the proofs, nothing has been proved in these slides, but the way the different lemmas are combined in order to obtain the final result. The final result, this existence of advertising equilibria, then a brief discussion of the weakness of this equilibria, when I said to you earlier, are so strong these competitive equilibria? But not so strong. And then I will show you the result of a numerical simulation. So of the market firm's market share for a particular case. Obviously, it's a simulation. We have chosen something that is quite common in this literature, so the asymmetric conditions. We will see after what do I mean when I say an asymmetrical scenario. Then we will discuss a bit of the contribution of our paper, merits and defects, especially the defects. And then I have added a massive, I have to say, extensive bibliography on advertising models. I will show you what are the papers we have improved, but actually I will show you also which kind of different problems there are in these areas, what are the new trends, where the research is going, not just in the mathematical sense, not just in the pure marketing sense, but also in terms of what is called a network game theory, so game theory on network, so supply chains and this kind of things. So with the, no, that does not, it's very different from the number of firms involved in the situation. It's the hierarchy at which the firms are organized. So it's a bit different from the numbers of firms. So these are the things I'm going to talk about. Okay, so let's start. So advertising models. So firms' advertising expenditure is an investment over time. So we have mainly firms, they have some money in the pocket, and they want to spend the money in order to advertise their products. That's common thing worldwide. Types of advertising we have in the literature? Well, the first thing is something that you know, I think, very well, which is called informative or generic advertising. In general, is used by governments. For example, I want to advertise the milk, but not the milk that I produce, but just the category milk. Because also I say the milk is good, the milk contains good substances, blah, 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 blah. Then there is the brand advertising. So my message to people, to the consumers, is a little bit different. I say, okay, I produce this milk. My milk contains particular proteins or things, particular things, or for example, does not contain fat for people who has cholesterol, high cholesterol, for example. So I'm mainly doing a kind of brand advertising. So I'm targeting a little bit. As a subcategory of this advertising, we have the so-called predatory. So imagine that the size of the market to some extent is not fixed. So I could also target my product, targets or consumers for other consumers for my product. So when I do brand advertising, I have two choices, or to attract new consumers that actually don't consume milk, or another option is to be a predator. So I steal consumers from my competitors. So I steal consumers who are already drinking milk. So in this sense, predatory advertising is a subclass of brand advertising. Okay. Obviously, this does not happen always. Why? Imagine that you have, the market is completely saturated. So we have a certain set of consumers. All these consumers mainly drink milk. Okay, in this condition, if I do brand advertising, clearly I'm stealing consumers from my competitors. Obviously, brand advertising can coincide with the predatory in certain situations. For example, in this case, saturated markets, and everyone is informed about the product. Everyone is drinking milk. Okay. But in general, they are different. And in a variety of these models, actually, these two words are distinct. So I'm spending a bit of time on this because they are really milestone of this literature, if you want to study advertising models. Okay, the main thrust of advertising models is to examine optimal strategies which maximize the net present value of future cash flow. That's the thing that if you are an operation researcher, you understand a little bit for sure better. So what we want to do is to choose the right strategy. What is the right strategy? What is the right amount of money I have to put into these expenditures, advertising expenditures, in order to do what? To maximize my profit. What is my profit? Okay, profit is classical, but is over the time. So I have the time affecting this. So maybe I can change a strategy. Maybe I can discount what I earn tomorrow, and because what I earn today is very different from what I will earn tomorrow. So there are different mathematical objects which could be inserted when we say maximize the net present value of future cash flows, obviously. And this is what operation research, game theory aims at in terms of solutions, to find these equilibria solutions that are a little bit different from optimal solutions. In our case, the paper we are talking about is properly one of those. So first of all, we have a duopolistic situation. So just two firms. Discounting model. So I inserted the discount factor into my analysis. Okay. So heterogeneous goods. So we can swap from a product to another one. This is not, I haven't talked about this, but this is not completely common in this environment. So in a product category, so milk. So I produce a certain milk, my competitors, they produce other milk. No? Effects, my model, both effects. So generic or informative and predatory advertising. Both effects inserted into the model. Other features, linear advertising costs. Oh, advertising as a cost, which is the main problem. So otherwise we were talking about nothing, because if advertising was priceless, okay, so the more you advertise, the better it is, whatever it is, no? So obviously as a cost. And in particular, something which is not so common in the literature, advertised prices. Why? Let me open a small window of this. There are another category of advertising models where you mainly don't advertise just the product, but you can advertise also the price. No? For example, I sell the milk 1 euro, no? So, and the price informs people and moves the consumer's preferences. This is a little bit a different category of model, so I just skipped a little bit in order not to confuse the main domain, the main action of the of advertising, which is mainly the usual thing, so saying good things about what you produce. Mature markets with the potential expansion for consumption. Okay, in my model, what we have, the situation that I was talking earlier. So we have the market is fixed, and that's very important to say. So it's a compact subset. Okay, first. But the market is not saturated. So as I was saying earlier, brand and predatory assume two different shapes. So not necessarily to do brand advertising means to do predatory advertising. Okay. But the size of the market is fixed. So we don't have an unlimited way to expand the market through our advertising efforts. So we can't convince everyone in Italy or in Spain to drink milk, just to be clear. But there are some people that will never enter the market. They will ever always say no to the milk because they don't like the milk. Okay, so this is the what my model has inside mainly. So let's structure a bit the model more mathematically speaking. So XIT, what is the market share? What is the market share? The market share is the slice of the cake, the slice of the market. So how many people they buy my product? And that's clear. So XIT is the market share of firm I at the time t. So a greater, obviously, greater or equal than zero. So informed market, the sum of the two slices. Okay. Duopolistic, so we have just two firms. One minus t, the potential market. People who do not drink, they don't drink milk, pardon. But, they can be affected by the advertising strategy, so they can buy some milk from someone. So, but one is the unitary saturated market. We can't go, we can't overcome the quantity one. So, PI, advertising price. So we advertise the price in this case, and this is fixed. So this is fixed. 1 euro. CI, marginal cost of good. Obviously, we have also some economic parameter, variables or parameters, if you want, depends on the model. So, CI is a marginal cost of good, so the production of the good. RI, classical revenue from the good, so price minus cost for the firm I, obviously. RO, as I said earlier, discount rate. Advertising variables. So I have the advertising expenditure of firm A. This is my effort, or how much money I put. BI, UI, these are the so-called return function. So I put money, okay, into the advertising. What is the return to me? BI and AI, they describe this. So BI UI is the brand advertising return for I, where BI is called the ineffectiveness of brand advertising return. Oh, so the fact that it's called ineffectiveness, as you understand, it depends just on the shape of this function. So BI is a little bit a negative noise. That's why it's called ineffectiveness. But the shape is the classical shape of diminishing returns, no, for people who likes economics. The same kind of mathematical shape is for the generic advertising return. So we have two kinds of returns. So I put the money in the brand advertising and I have a return. I have a return from the brand advertising. I put the money in the return advertising, in the generic advertising, and I have a return from this action. No? And ROI is the effectiveness of predatory advertising. So ROI describes a little bit, in a way we will see the equations. So ROI describes how much I'm good at stealing consumers from another, from one of my competitors. Okay. So having in mind this set of variables, so the differential equations that you can see here appears, in my opinion, a little bit more clear. So what is XIT? As usual, the dot is the derivative, no? So how the market share for company I, for firm I, changes time by time. How it changes? I said at the beginning, I have both effects, predatory and generic. So let's see the generic effect. It's the first addend, this one. So what happens? AI, so the my effort plus the effort of my colleague. This is proportional to what remains in the market. 1 minus XIT plus XJT plus predatory, or also called, this model is called the Lancaster model in literature. Predatory. Okay. This is my market share. I am I. So ROI times the what? The population, the market share of my opponent. How much I'm still? Times the return of this investment. This is the first addend is the part that I steal from my competitor. And the second part is the part for which I've been stolen from my competitor. So it's minus, clearly. Rho J, so is the capability of my competitor to steal me, to steal from me, and the usual things. XI, so my population, my market share. BJ, the return of my competitor, obviously. So first effect, the generic advertising. Second effect, the predatory. The second addend and the third addend, they describe what in general literature is called the Lancaster mode. You can find easily many references to this. The first part described is the first addend is a classical what in this literature are called the diffusive models. And the prototype of these models, the classical prototype, is the famous bus diffusion model. No? So, okay, classical system of differential equations, nothing to say. XI zero, no, is the classical initial conditions. So when time starts, how the market shares are distributed among firms. This is not trivial, no? And, you know, we could, even if this equation are quite, they have a good linearity, but actually the initial conditions, they could be a bit critical for the solutions. Expenditure strategy, how much money I put into advertising. The interesting thing in this paper, this model, is the fact that when I put the money for the brand advertising and for the generic advertising at the same way. This is a defect of this paper, I'm telling you. But because of the complexity of this model, of this equation, and these equations have been treated by few people. So we paid some, you know, like trade-off in terms of complexity. So we needed to use the same expenditure for brand and generic. But in some other models, some authors, they modeled these in different ways. So I have a variable for the informative, a variable for the brand. And so the trade-off between these two variables is very interesting. I will show you one of these papers at the end. So what is my payoff? My payoff is clear now. So over the time, so a nice integral of what? RI, the revenue of my market times my market share, so RI times XIT, minus what? Minus what, how much I have spent in this, in the expenditure, so minus UI. All this is discounted by the time, so RO is a discount factor. So why? But it's clear that this integral depends on UI, very clear. But the fact that it depends on UJ is a little bit less clear. But the dependence comes from the equation, the differential equations at the top here. So solving this gives the dependence of XI by the UJ. So also this integral, because contains XI, contains UJ, depends on UJ, let me say better. So all this integral depends also on UJ. So this payoffs depends from my action, my strategy UI, and UJ. So, and I think you can see now the settings of a non-cooperative game. So I have my strategies. I can spend as much money as I like. We are assuming that these firms are really rich. They have lots of money to spend in advertising. But that's not in general true. You can have, for example, a compact subset. That would be nice to have, actually. And a payoff. My payoff depends also on the strategies of my opponent. So classical non-cooperative settings. So because we are in a classical non-cooperative settings, the best definitions to describe these are Nash equilibrium. So what is a Nash equilibrium? Mainly is, just recalling a bit definition, a point, in this case, a set of, like a couple of investments, such that if my competitor does not change the strategy, as that strategy, the one prescribed by the Nash equilibrium, then to me, for me, it's not convenient to move from my Nash strategy. Does not compete. For me, it's not convenient. It's optimal. Then it's optimal. But it does not mean that it's optimal in general. So. This is the classical definition of Nash equilibrium, super celebrated worldwide. Not very much to say about that. But what is a strong Nash equilibrium? Strong Nash equilibrium is mainly an equilibrium where what I said earlier is true, but what happens is a little bit of refinement. So in case I move, I don't find nothing equal to what I've left in case I deviate. So it's like a strict in mathematical terms. In general, it's called also strict sometimes, this definition, but because of some game theoretical interpretation, it's called strong in general. But you can find also the word strict sometimes. And let me add, when you have more than two players, in this case two firms, strong gives a little bit better the idea of what a strong Nash equilibrium is. So these are the generic solutions. What means free riding and non-out? Okay, free riding, it's very clear in this context what free riding means. So let's assume that I put money in generic advertising. I make people buy milk. No? Okay. Because I'm a good company, I'm a good person. Okay, my competitor knows that and does not spend €1 on this. So he's free riding the system. So it would be nice to have equilibrium that do not have this defect. They do not have the free riding. Normal equilibrium, nothing to say. You know very well what does it mean. Okay, so these are the solutions. Okay. What are the assumptions that I need to have in order to have my final result? So what is the weakness? I'm going to show you. What I'm assuming, and this is an assumption, of mine. What I'm assuming is that CI and PI are a little bit distant. But if I advertise price PI, CI then, because it needs to be distant from EI, goes down. CI is the production cost, how much money I spend in producing the milk. So if CI goes down, goes down. It means that I'm producing at low quality. How much far CI and PI must have? No, in this definition, it's a definition. We will see in a while why, but why I need this definition. They need to be distant this quantity. CISH, no? So CIHS is marketing incentive I've called for firm I. How they are this quantity is organized? No, so it's mainly a mixture, no, of some basic operations on the parameter of the models, rho I, rho j, no? So you remember, rho I, rho j are the capability to steal, no, the competitors, the consumers from my competitor. Fi, bi are the ineffectiveness coefficients in the set of return functions. But it's not very important how this number is composed, but what is very important is how this number is here to separate the production costs from the advertisers' prices. So, these marketing incentives, they have some properties. I've written here something about. They are very trivial properties, actually. From the formulation of these marketing incentives, you understand immediately these properties. But one thing that is interesting to highlight is the fact that these incentives, they increase with the aggressivity of my competitors, which is nice. So what happens now? The more my competitor is aggressive, so Roger increases. So CI, my incentive as a firm I, increase. So CI here, so increase. So CI is starts to become quite far from PI. So the more my competitor is aggressive, the more my production costs are going to be lowered, now to be decreased. So competition is a nice thing. Well, don't know. So obviously they are definitions. But when definitions are useful to establish an equilibrium, things are going to change. And this is the main result. Assume that both firms have these marketing incentives. Assume some basic and very mild assumptions on the discount rate. First of all, it's not null, and it's not very high. It's quite small, quite close to zero. So, theorem, a strong Nash equilibrium pure strategy exists. It is not null, and it is not a free-riding equilibrium. And as I said earlier, I would like to have, an equilibrium which is not a free-riding equilibrium. I enjoy this property, no? Because free-riding is not good in general, or in general does not give great stability to the system, no? Because if everyone free-rides, at some point the system will collapse. So, this is the main result. How to arrive at this result? The quick way to the proof. So I'm showing the step. I'm not going into very much details because I think I cannot go to my very much detail. But let me show the different steps and the technique used, which is important for you if you want to study this kind of problems, obviously. So, the first thing when you study Nash equilibria is the concept of best reply. So what is a best reply? So it's like, okay, I do this. I choose a certain strategy, not the Nash equilibrium, a certain strategy. What is your reply to me? Obviously, the reply of my competitor are the best, according to what I do. So if I call you two, the strategy on firm two, no? Assume that the best reply to strategy U2 exists. Assume this for a while. The reply to the strategy of company of firm two is U1. No, sorry. So how U1 and U2 are related between them, if they satisfy this beautiful equation? As you can see, this is a curve, order 4. So U1 4, U1 3, U1 2, now U1. And there are horrible coefficients here, no? H, B, no? You can see, no? All these coefficients. So now it's not important to read these coefficients. It's completely uninfluential for the talk. But what is important is to show the shape of these coefficients. Oh, have a look at, hello, here we have B, C, D, F, G, H, N, and these two, theta and P, or I think it's a P. So here we have H, B, D, no, this is the equation, no? So B, C, D, C, G, H, no, all these coefficients, so completely detailed in here, okay? Have a look. In all these expressions, there is this theta and phi. Look where there is the dependence of from the variable U2. Is in theta and phi. So these coefficients, they depend on U2, the initial strategy of company 2. Let's go back to the equation. So these coefficients of this curve, they depend on U2. They are not properly, let me say, coefficients. So they are, because they depend on U2. So if I choose, if I fix U2, then what is the best reply to U2? Is a U1. But how U1 and U2 are related to each other by this? And U2 does not disappear from this equation because it's inside H, D, B, as you can see from here. Theta and phi here, theta, phi here. So B depends on U2. So C depends on U2, and so on. So we have a parametric, a set of parametric curves, you know, describing this, and that's the difficulty. That's the difficulty. So, what can we say? How can we study that horrible curve? No, so horrible in the sense that because it's complicated. So, a couple of lemmas, interesting lemmas, useful lemmas, more than interesting. So, if we have the discount rate quite close to zero as usual and not null, and the revenue, my revenue, firm one, satisfy this inequality, then the fourth coefficient is strictly negative. The fourth coefficient, I mean, the fourth coefficient of the equation. So, is this one. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, this one. All this quantity is strictly negative. For every U2. Similar result for the fifth coefficient, if a certain condition, a sufficient condition, is satisfied. Where is the fifth condition? This one, in the famous equation. Using the technique of Zero's theorem, the variations of the sign in an equation, so we are able to draw some important results. This is a set of further lemmas, where we study the correspondence, the best reply, which is not anymore a correspondence or a multifunction, but it's just a function. So, because consider that when I choose a strategy, the optimal strategy of my competitor can be also, how can I say, more than one. So it's not a function, it's a multifunction. So, but in this case, are functions. And under these sufficient conditions, there exists a unique best reply, U1, for any strategy U2. That's a very important lemma, and this is the fruit of these previous lemmas. Using this Zeros technique, we are able to prove what I showed you from at the beginning, this, the main result. And the main result has inside this assumption, have marketing incentive, which means this. So the lowering of the production costs. So to be competitive, being aggressive in terms of advertising, predatory, generic, altogether, makes the performance of the market better? No. At least from this analysis, no. Because the production costs are going down. So your milk will be not a great milk. Because two firms, they need to compete in showing you the qualities of their milk. And actually, we would prefer to drink good milk, no? Or not, as a consumer. Okay, so I have mainly, I'm watching, I am on the track. So what I'm going to show now is a simulation. So we have the equilibrium in our hands, but now what is interesting to see and how the market shares are at this equilibrium. That is very interesting. So market share is the slice of the cake, how the two firms, they divide the market. But this depends on the strategies. But now we have one strategy. We have Nash equilibrium in our hands. So we can study something which is a little bit stationary, no? So in terms of solution. But to do that, obviously, we need to reduce the complexity of the probe, the scenario, all these parameters that are full of parameters. So we make a choice. And we choose something a little bit asymmetrical, as you can see. So ineffective, so generic advertising return, ineffective brand advertising return. We have chosen some numbers. We have computed also the market incentives. We have chosen the advertised marginal prices, the marginal cost. Pardon. Look at the discount rate, very, very low, because in my assumption, in our assumptions, we need something very close to the zero, As you can see, the firm one, why is it asymmetric? The firm one is actually stronger. Look at the predatory capability, row one, is greater than row two. It's more aggressive, no? So, and look at alpha one and B one, beta one, pardon. Five and five, we have chosen. Consider that they are ineffectiveness coefficient, no? So the less they are, the better for the firm is. So don't forget this. We have called at the beginning, you remember, I said these coefficients are a bit reversed, no? In fact, 5 against 10, 5 against 15. It means that firm 1 is stronger in terms of returns than firm 2, even if these two numbers are, they say the opposite. Okay, this is the frame of our simulation. So we found a beautiful mathematical expression of the market share in function of what? Of the equilibrium. So XI is the market share of the market at the time T, I don't want to talk about this form, this coefficient. What is just important to say at this point is look at the dependence of the market share from the strategy, the equilibrium strategy, UI equilibrium. UI equilibrium, A is depends on U1 equilibrium, depends on U2 equilibrium, and so on. So XI, if I define all the parameters and if I am able to have the expression of the proper numerical expression of the Nash equilibria, I know perfectly the shape of this, of the market shares. So we did this, yes, we did. We did how we have found the numerical values of the Nash equilibria. But we have used a little bit Mathematica. No? We have used the Mathematica, we have used the some routines in order to have a bit of approximation of the Nash equilibria. Nothing very, towards the computational complexity, but more about the numerical evaluation. So we have done this. I will show you now what happens to the market share. So red, blue, and green. Now, red is the line of the stronger firm one, blue the line of the weakest one, and green is the total market. So next slide shows the dynamics of market share under the condition that the market is not saturated. So in the market we have space, there are some not informed consumers, and what can change? What is the variation to the team? The initial conditions. So let's see what happens. It's interesting to see. For example, for these initial conditions, look at, I said the red is the strongest one. Okay, look at the red line. So this is the market share of the company, the strongest on the market. It's increasing. Look at the blue, the weakest firm. No? Actually, it's increasing. At some point increasing, there is an optimal point in terms of market share. Over the time, these are functions over the time, the market shares over the time. At some point, starts to going down. This is the total market, informed market. As you can see, in the long run, the total market will be informed, but this is quite expectable, will be informed. So everyone will consume milk. So. But what is interesting here is the fact that even if so at the beginning, the strongest firm needs some time in order to erode the capital in terms of market share from company two. So for company two, for firm two, there is an optimal time to stop the game in order to have the maximum of the market shares over the time. If we use generic and predatory advertising. What is this time? We have computed in this case, we have a formulation, a mathematical framework, and, which is a good thing because it's quite computational speaking is interesting. Look at this, the same case when the two firms, they have the initial conditions, same market shares. Obviously, the firm one goes up, the firm two goes down. There is nothing to do. The market is totally saturated. Next slide shows the dynamics of market share under the condition that the market is saturated. So at the beginning, it is saturated. Everyone is drinking milk. So the unique action that I can do is to steal from my competitor. And no more than this. For example, firm one and firm two, they share the same equal, half the market. For example, firm one is initially much stronger on the market. Firm one. So look, is increasing. is continuing increasing. But if this does not happen, if firm one is initially initially strong, but not very much stronger, look at the difference of the shape. It's decreasing. Obviously, they are going to saturate the market. I have an evaluation of the market share regime, no? So for great times, and also all these informations. And these market share are at equilibrium. But it's interesting to see how this the monotonicity changes according to the initial conditions. So it's not true that if the market is saturated, things do not change. Change, stealing each other in a very strange way. Yeah? So it depends on how much you have more than the others when we start to steal, because we steal proportionally to what you have. So merits of our contribution, but the paper is over. So the merits for sure to have included predatory and generic advertising effects. First of all, not many scholars have done this, honestly. So, and we have used a model more complex than the one provided in BAS. What is the defect? Static solution. We have used static solution. There is another class of solutions where the strategies can change over the time. In our case, we don't change over the time our strategy. You choose a time zero that your investment is this, finished. But you can use open loop, closed loop, or feedback mesh equilibria if you want. So where the strategies, they can change time by time, readjusting according to the evolution of the market. And this, the mathematics behind that is more complicated. It's not easy to solve very complex initial models using dynamic solutions. The economic interpretation is for sure a merit of this paper, in my opinion, in our opinion. So, and these are the merits and defects of the contribution. New trends, I think I'm over. So, new trends. First of all, enjoy the promiscuity, let me say, between generic and brand advertising, finding new models. I have some ideas in my mind, actually. Another trend, I think is a very modern trend from 2014-15, is to study these models on supply chains. So mainly, you don't have firms at the same level, but you have a hierarchy. So you have a producer and a retailer, for example. So the producer produces the good, gives to the retailer sells the good. Okay, fair enough. Both they have interest in promoting the good. One because he's selling, and the other because he's producing. But the way the decisions are taken are at different levels of this hierarchy. At the seller decides the price, and the producer decides the cost. Complicated. And we can use also cooperative game theory, for example. We stay together, we decide together to do things, and then we share the profits. And another approach is not the non-cooperative approach, it's the cooperative approach. Okay. This is more. You can read other things from the slide, but this paper has been published. These are the coordinates on International Game Theory Review, a famous special issue devoted to the Singh 13 in Paris. So, Singh is a conference in game theory, is the Spain, Italy, Netherlands games. And is annually held in one of the European universities. So I have finished. Here you find a bit of I'm a bit late, so I would like to discuss this bibliography, but you find a very extensive bibliography with all advertising models described over 25-30 years of literature. Okay, so thank you and sorry for being a little bit longer.
Thank you very much, Francesco. Now, it's really interesting. We had Vito here last year. Vito Fagnelli. Well, now it's the turn of question. Please write on the chat or switch on your camera and your mic. Thank you very much.
Okay, I would like Francesco to give you, thanks you for your nice talk. I think it was very fun, and you talk about some, what I like the most was that you give some ideas about the proof, but now we are not used to do that in seminars and in talk, because we have no time. We are always in a hurry when we are presenting something, so that is very nice. I had the past two questions, and now I had just one, because one of these you answer when you talk about the possibility of cooperation, because you know that I'm working on cooperative game theory, so the main question it came to my mind was, do you think it's possible that the firms can cooperate, can think on cooperation on this investment in advertising expenditure? It should be possible. It is not realistic, because what I want to say is that I am advising a PhD student, and we are talking about some different model, but they are cooperative, and we are thinking on the possibility to study a cooperative model for this kind of advertising expenditure. So I would like to know your opinion, and maybe we can talk later after the talk, or maybe another day or something like that.
I can tell you something a little bit quick. I think they can do. I'm not very much sure about the variety of the solutions that you can apply, because mainly in this kind of context, because you don't have a central authority, so you need the individual rationality anytime. So every firm needs to have something back from this cooperation to some extent. And these obviously, for example, in my opinion, cuts completely out the concept of, for example, of the shape value or
but the core, maybe, because in the core you have the individual rationality, or maybe we can create ad hoc solution.
Yeah, the core, but the core is already studied very much.
So there exists literature on cooperation on that, you say.
You can see, I can give you some.
It could be nice to know some, especially for the PhD student, because he's trying to develop a cooperative model.
This is a very nice host, vertical cooperative advertising in supply chain.
This is a book.
Oppure you can find this paper, Cooperative Advertising Model in Supply Chain Management, European Journal of Research.
Okay,
good. And a review where they study very much this kind of problem on hierarchy, because they study, you can have one producer, one retailer. Then you can have multiple producers and one retailer. Another set, for example, is the strategy online. So a kind of extension where the strategy is taken by the retailer, selling or not selling online.
Okay, I see.
This creates an enormous amount of variety of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, I think maybe he can read a little bit this book, or maybe this paper, and trying to see, because what he's studying is a kind of cooperation in bakery, in a bakery system in Colombia, because he's a Colombian student. But anyway, in fact, maybe if we have, maybe we need to talk a little bit, maybe we can send an email and we can have some meeting or something like that. Yeah. Okay, and the second question is about, as you talked before, when you use UI, you mean the investment advertising expenditure or advertising expenditure, you say that, we are allowed an infinite, amount. And what I say, what I got to ask you is that, maybe you use that because it's easier to work with a model, with a mathematical model, but there is any change if you assume that you have a upper bound for your expenditure, because we are not, I mean, the capacity and the money is not a limit. It's not, it's not a limit. We have always limit.
I don't think there is a change on that, but this depends on the final proof of the this.
Okay.
Because I'm telling you why I don't think there is a change. I'm telling you the point where I don't think there is a change here.
In the right,
a form of coercivity.
Okay.
That actually never. It's not very important. Don't mind very much how a set, if that set is compact or not.
Okay, I see. So,
I don't think it depends. I have to check a bit cap, but I'm pretty much sure in the following the proof that does not depend on that.
Okay, thank you again for, I don't know if any other student, because I see that there are a lot of PhD students of our two programs, the programs in the PhD in economy and also in the statistic and optimization. So if one of them want to ask you something, maybe there is no more questions. Okay, so thank you, Francesco, for your nice talk. It was a pleasure that you visited virtually, and I hope in the future you will come, you will be able to come in a presential way and enjoy here in Elche with us for a few days.
First of all, let me say thanks to you and to the department and to all the people here. So it's been a pleasure for me. Yes, unfortunately, we cannot eat any Spanish food together. So that's the
Most of the students thank you in the chat. They are saying that they enjoy you explaining a theoretical and practical. So they say that they like that. So
yeah, no, I'm happy for that. I gave the idea of the proof to invite someone to work on that, honestly, to modify the model and to reuse the proof in order to have some similar results. You know, it's a way to optimize, to do something more, you know, other papers. So who wants to work on that? I'm quite available to, I don't know, instruct or give details.
Okay, thank you again. So we will be in touch. Have a good time. Bye-bye to everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for everybody.
Ciao. Bye. Ciao.